Recorded Books and RB Digital present Auntie Poldi and the Vineyards of Etna by Mario Giordano. Translated by John Brownjohn. Narrated by Matt Addis.
Chapter 1. Tells of water, mongrels, shadows and deliziosi, and of the family's worries about Poldi's inner equilibrium. Poldi is now a star in Torre Akirafi and has tasted blood, which means that a clash with Commissario Montana is almost inevitable. Once the call of the genes rings out, however, Poldi is not to be deterred by heat, showers of volcanic ash, or German tourists. Someone had not only cut off the water supply to the whole of the Via Baronessa, but poisoned Lady. Thirst and murder. In other words, my Auntie Poldi's two pet hates. They upset her inner equilibrium even more than the sight of a handsome, immaculately turned out Sicilian traffic cop. Lady was one of two friendly mongrels that belonged to Valerie, my Auntie Poldi's neighbour. A stumpy, shaggy, yappy mutt with a pronounced underbite, she used to hunt Femina Morta's rats with her twin brother Oscar and welcome visitors to the property. Everyone, simply everyone who knew Lady had loved her, because she generously gave her heart to them all. Whenever visitors came calling, she would go crazy with eagerness to make the acquaintance of strangers or celebrate a reunion with friends. She even endeared herself, in the space of a tail wag, to Valerie's misanthropic French relations. The workers in Valerie's palm plantation could be heard calling Lady all day long, followed by Lady's hoarse, delighted response. Until one morning, when her shaggy little body was found in the courtyard stiff as a board. Poisoned bait, according to the vet. So it went without saying that my Auntie Poldi, being the obstinate Bavarian she was, had to rebalance things and get them back on an even keel. In other words, get the taps running again, find Lady's murderer, and see justice done. Especially as it mustn't be forgotten that my Auntie Poldi already lived on the knife edge between joie de vivre and melancholia. The least she wanted was to straighten things out, because straightening things out was always something of an aid to getting over her fits of depression. Auntie Poldi was the widow of my late Uncle Pepe, who, in contrast to his parents and his sisters Teresa, Caterina, and Luisa, had not returned to Sicily in the 1970s, but remained in Munich like my father. My Uncle Pepe was a Münchner through and through. I can't remember him when he didn't have a stein of beer in one hand and a cheap cigar in the other. He spoke only Bayerisch and Sicilian, never ran to regular German or Italian. Uncle Pepe had always been the black sheep of the family, the cool dude notorious for his countless affairs, shady cronies, wild parties, falls from grace, spectacular car crashes, walk-on parts in films, bankruptcies, and harebrained business ventures. My favourite uncle, in other words. All that stabilised him somewhat was his marriage in later life to a certain Isolde Oberreiter, known as Poldi. They were a glamorous couple, Pepe and Poldi. Svelte as rock stars, chain-smokers, boozers, open-handed and generous, and, according to my mother, the most caring friends imaginable. At some stage, I recall my parents saying that Pepe and Poldi were getting divorced, and they didn't seem particularly surprised. Uncle Pepe remarried the following year. Then he died, and we lost touch with Poldi. A few years later, we heard from Aunt Teresa that Poldi had bought a house in Tanzania, but that was pretty much all anyone knew. And then, out of the blue, Poldi reappeared in Munich. Having inherited her parents' small house, she sold up, burnt all her bridges, and on her 60th birthday moved to Torre Akirafi, a peaceful little town on the east coast of Sicily between Catania and Taormina, intending to drink herself to death in comfort within sight of the sea. Suicide with a sea view was her plan. Nobody quite knew why. All my aunts did know was that someone had to do something about it, and someone included me. because in their view, I was as good as unemployed. Thereafter, I flew to Sicily to spend 1 week a month in Poldi's guest room at number 29 Via Baronessa, working on my family epic and helping to dispose of her liquor supplies. Although in the past few months Poldi had temporarily thwarted death thanks to solving her handyman Valentino's murder, her romantic encounter with Vito Montana, Polizia di Stato's chief inspector in charge of homicide cases, her friendship with her neighbours Valerie and sad Signora Cocuzza, my aunt's efforts, and last but not least, her own love of the chase. We all know the way of the world. Peace reigns for a while. The worst seems to be over. The sun breaks through the clouds. The future beckons once more. Your cigarette suddenly tastes good again. The air hums with life. And the whole world becomes a congenial place pervaded by whispers of great things to come. A simply wonderful, universally familiar sensation. And then, like a bolt from the blue, pow! Not that anyone has seen it coming, but the wind changes. Fate empties a bucket of excrement over your head, chuckling as it does so, and all you can think is, wow, now I really need a drink. And the whole shitty process starts again from scratch. So it was no wonder my aunts became rather alarmed when Poldi still had no running water after 2 weeks and Lady was murdered. No doubt about it. The wind had changed, and the ice was growing steadily thinner.
You must come, Aunt Louisa told me on the phone. Right away.
I tried to wriggle out of it.
I can't, I said. I'm working on an ultra-urgent pitch for TV, a pre-watershed parental guidance thriller. Not my genre exactly, but it could be a slam dunk. Just a moment.
With a sigh, Louisa handed the receiver to her sister Teresa, who's the boss in our family. It was obvious what that meant. Game over. I heard Louisa whisper something in Italian, then the gentle, still youthful voice of my Aunt Teresa.
How are you, Tesoro? Making progress with your novel?
I might have known.
I'm getting on pretty well, I prevaricated. The first chapter's as good as finished. All I need is a bit of...
You're frittering your time away,
Aunt Teresa told me gently.
What you need is to concentrate on essentials.
She had a point.
And you could keep an eye on Poldi at the same time.
I said nothing, and Aunt Teresa switched to Italian, the invariable sign that a storm was brewing.
She's fond of you, you know.
Eh?
She is, for some reason. We often talk about you.
In what way? I asked suspiciously. Aunt Teresa didn't pursue the matter.
This television thing, is it very important to you?
Direct hit. Hold below the waterline. I landed at Catania at lunchtime next day, was regaled by Teresa with spaghetti al nero di seppia, and meekly answered all the aunt's inquiries about the welfare of the family members in Germany. That evening I was back on the sofa in my Auntie Poldi's house in Torre Achirafi, and the strangest thing was, I felt thoroughly at home, and far closer to my mess of a family saga than I had for a long time. You're developing a little tummy, was the first thing Poldi said when she came to the door.
Thanks a lot. I'm glad you're glad I'm here again.
She ushered me inside. I'm only saying, a little tummy suits any man, as long as it's firm, that's all. Bear this in mind for your novel. Doesn't matter what you're talking about, art or sex, it's all a question of proportion. I ignored her aphorism and scanned my surroundings. There was one reassuring feature. Her plan to drink herself to death with a sea view seemed to be in abeyance. I could detect no caches of empty liquor bottles. The house made a clean and tidy impression. The pot plants on the terrace had been adequately watered, and the fridge was full of vegetables. No signs of neglect. But, as I said, it was a knife-edge situation, a somnambulist's dance on the rim of a volcanic crater. Not even the aunts seriously expected Poldi to remain stone-cold sober from one day to the next, but she really did drink no more than a bottle of Prosecco a day. plus half a litre of beer at lunch and a little goretto, a coffee with a shot of cognac in the afternoon. She was looking as fresh as a daisy, titivated and fragrant in a billowing silk caftan, with her wig skilfully dressed. She undertook a daily passeggiata along the esplanade. On Mondays she went down to the beach. On Tuesdays she accompanied Uncle Martino to the fish market in Catania. On Wednesdays she sunned herself at the Lido Galatea with Aunt Luisa. On Thursdays she took tea with Valerie. Fridays meant bed with Commissario Montana. Saturdays gin rummy with Signora Cocuzza and Padre Paolo. On Sundays she occasionally went mushroom picking with Teresa and Martino, and at all times she relished the newfound local notoriety she had earned by solving the Candela case in such a spectacular fashion. What am I saying local? Even the Augsburger Heimatkurier had interviewed her on the subject. In short, my Auntie Poldi was on a roll. Ever since she figured out who killed her handyman, she was the star of Torre Akirafi. Everyone asked her for selfies and sent her wedding invitations. She even attended mass regularly, Padre Paolo officiating, because this more or less accorded with her new social status in the town. She had also acquired a Vespa. Not just any old Vespa either, but a restored PX125cc decorated like a Carretto Siciliano by my cousin Marco, who has a talent for such things. It was adorned with traditional designs like those on Sicilian donkey carts, which make even Indian tuk-tuks look drab and boring. Ornamentation in vivid colours, plenty of curlicues, and in this particular instance, skillfully airbrushed illustrations of Poldi at work on the Candela case. "Don't tell me," I said a trifle enviously when she showed me the Vespa. "Restraint is a sign of weakness?" "Hey, don't go thinking I've lost the plot. I like colourful things, that's all. Vanity doesn't come into it. It's just a tribute to our traditions."
"Our traditions?"
"Being Sicilian is a question of heart, not genes. And I know a thing or two about matters of the heart, believe you me. I've always known I was Sicilian in an earlier life. Masai and Sicilian. I just sense it. Katie told me that back in Los Angeles."
"And which Katie would that be?"
"Why, Katie Hepburn, of course. Not a lot of people know this, but she had the gift. Fantastic woman. Crazy, but all heart. Hey, maybe I should go to a fortune teller and do a regression. What do you think?"
My Auntie Poldi wasn't the type to put things on the back burner, or put up for long with thirst and unsolved murders, and that was always a source of trouble. October is one of the loveliest months in Sicily. It's when summer opens its fist again, letting a little breeze into the house and allowing you to breathe again, when the light becomes as mellow as my Aunt Caterina's limoncello and you take a sweater along in the evenings just to be on the safe side. When the shacks and timber decks on the Torre Akirafi's esplanade have disappeared along with the charivari of children's cries, raucous laughter, flirtations, minor dramas and covert glances at suntanned skin. When you're still receiving envious text messages from home about the weather you're enjoying, when waiters in bars become talkative again, and the first snow falls on the heights of Etna. When the grape harvest is in progress somewhat lower down, between Tre Castagni and Zafferana, and you're faced with the alarming question of whether the local cafe has run out of Granita di Gelsi or Mulberry Sorbet. But this October was different. Still as hot as a molten glass bubble stubbornly pressing down on the whole island and intent on withering the last remaining wisp of greenery. A sirocco from North Africa was blowing half the Sahara across the Mediterranean, sandblasting throats and the bodywork of cars, and migraines and forest fires were rife. What exacerbated the situation was Etna's continuous activity. For weeks now, the main crater had been surmounted by a column of smoke more than 1,000 meters high, and spectacular eruptions and streams of lava were on display every night. The Mongibello, the mountain of mountains, groaned and snorted every minute of the day and night, emitting muffled salutations from the bowels of the earth that preyed on people's nerves and shook them to the core.
When the Sirocco took a breather, Etna showered Torayaki Rafi with fragments of pumice and particles of volcanic ash until snow shovels were all that could deal with the inches-thick deposit in the streets and on the roof terraces. Sicily was once more giving my Auntie Poldi a hard time. To make matters worse, she had recently been reminded by the persistent throbbing of an old crown top left that a visit to the dentist was long overdue. It was only a minor problem, but now that Poldi was more self-controlled drink-wise, that minor problem could not, alas, be solved by imbibing several stiff dry martinis, only by stubbornly ignoring it and taking half an ibuprofen. With the best will in the world, Poldi was not yet ready to undergo any Sicilian dentistry. As if that were not enough, there came a morning when every tap in the Via Baronessa emitted a dry cough. No need to panic, normally speaking. Sometimes the old water mains are to blame, sometimes just drought. Cuts usually last a day or two at most, and the blue plastic tank on your roof will tide you over. It's a nuisance if a cut lasts any longer, a week, say, or two, or, as in this case, three. It's even more of a nuisance if the reason cannot be found and if only one particular street is affected, namely yours. To a Sicilian, the situation will usually be self-evident. Cosa Nostra is exerting pressure on one of your neighbours. The reasons can be many and various. Perhaps the neighbour is to be incentivized into signing a contract disadvantageous to himself. Perhaps he is behind with his payments under an existing contract, and cutting off his water is stage one in a two-stage admonitory process. Stage one, a veiled warning. Stage two, violence directed at you and your family. Then again, your neighbour may simply have been sent a message to keep his trap shut in some current court case. Nobody knows for sure, but the whole street suffers as a result. All the better, it only increases the pressure. Cutting off the water has long been one of Cosa Nostra's most effective forms of coercion. It demonstrates total control. Whoever controls the water supply rules Sicily. Like everyone else in Via Baronessa, Poldi had been obliged for 3 weeks to fetch her water in a jerry can from the public taps at the old mineral water bottling plant. Not a really satisfactory option, because the four taps were besieged by queues all day long. Even when her turn came, it took Poldi an age to fill her jerry can, after which she had to tote the whole whopping great thing home or heft it onto her Vespa. One jerry can was just enough for one person per day. Showering, going to the toilet, washing, cooking, everything became complicated. All at once, her whole daily routine revolved around water alone. The level of the water in the jerry can became a measure of her inner equilibrium, and full was only a fleeting moment, a dot on the timescale.
"You've no idea what a thirst I've got," she gasped, mopping her brow.
She did not, however, favour me by removing her wig.
"You tell me it's only psychological, of course. I know that myself, but it doesn't help. I could kill for a drink. Like another beer?"
"No, thanks," I lied.
"So, who is it, in your opinion?"
"Who's what?"
"The neighbour the Mafia's putting pressure on."
Poldi stared at me blankly.
"What sort of daft question is that? It's me, of course. Who do you think? The Mafia have had me in their sights ever since I solved Valentino's murder. That's as plain as a nose on your face."
"I thought the Mafia didn't have anything to do with Valentino's death."
"Not directly, but Italo Russo was behind it indirectly, and he, I tell you," she whispered, "is a capo mafioso, a boss of bosses."
"Which you can prove." She gave me a pitying look.
"I'm still at the very start of my investigations. But I've got a nose for mafiosi, arch-capitalistic bloodsuckers and dog murderers. It's an instinct of mine."
Poldi could not be weaned off the idea that Lady's death and the sabotaging of the water supply had only one purpose, to intimidate her.
"It's nearly broken Valerie's heart, and poor little Oscar is utterly down in the dumps. He howls and pines for Lady all day long."
But why was only Lady poisoned, not him as well? I asked.
I wondered that right away, because the pair were inseparable. So what's the only logical answer? It's that Lady was murdered deliberately, of course. And why did the killer pick on Lady and not Oscar? Because she was female, of course. Because the message was aimed at me, get it?
Wasn't that a bit far? A brusquely dismissive gesture.
And if I don't catch the bastard very soon, poor Oscar will also be for the chop, believe you me. Anyway, I've already conducted some preliminary investigations.
I got the picture at last. You mean your hunting instinct has been aroused, eh?
My, we're slowly adjusting to the same wavelength. You're slowly catching on.
Benvenuto in Sicilia. No doubt about it. Poldi had tasted blood. She'd heard the call of her father's genes and was prepared, like Detective Chief Inspector Oberreiter before her, to tread her predestined path. Criminology and the pursuit of justice. The only trouble was, there hadn't been another actual murder in the neighbourhood. This, combined with the heat and lack of water and her toothache, was resulting in violent thirst, dire fits of depression, and a kind of criminological cold turkey, a withdrawal symptom to which, according to my Auntie Poldi, retired and suspended detectives are particularly prone.
Imagine a superbrain functioning at full throttle and someone suddenly pulls the plug.
It really can't be good.
I mean, no top-level athlete can stop training from one day to the next. Their heart couldn't take it. They'd go fft. It's just the same with detectives' brains when there's nothing to detect. They're like dogs with nothing to chase and worry to death. They'll wind up mauling your sweater, or in the last resort some child's arm.
So what's left for me? It turned out that, as a sort of health measure, Poldi had consequently spent the week since my last visit trying to prove that Rousseau had links with the Mafia. Unsuccessfully hitherto, and no wonder, since her only clue was the photo of a topographical map she'd seen Rousseau discussing with Corrado Paternay, the building contractor from Riposto. Although Poldi still hadn't located the area in question, she was convinced that Rousseau had already smelt a rat, and was unmistakably telling her to drop her investigation by cutting off the water and murdering Lady. If she didn't, her Poldian logic dictated, it meant morto sicuro, or certain death.
But he's got another thing coming, that fine gentleman. Do I look like someone who wets her knickers just because some big head threatens me? I've already looked death in the face, I tell you. I know I'm not far short of my sell-by date, but till then, my lad, I'm going to pull out all the stops, amore-wise, criminologically and in general. And when the time comes, well, I know how to leave the stage. To roars of applause, I mean.
My Auntie Poldi knew a thing or two about amore, criminology and death. So she embarked on her investigation of the Lady case with total professionalism. In other words, no one was above suspicion. She descended on Femina Morta in her dark blue trouser suit, which pinched in places like a cleansing tsunami breaking on a dirty, jetsam-strewn beach.
"Weren't you a bit too hot in a trouser suit?" I interjected. "I mean, in this sweltering heat."
"Nonsense! It was a must." "Why?" "Because a blue trouser suit is the ideal no-joking-matter look for any woman who's negotiating contracts or arresting or dating idiots of every description. In American crime series, they're always worn by grouchy, ponytailed women detectives. You know the type I mean? They aren't your type, of course. They've no sense of humour. One false word and wham! You're flat on the ground with a knee in the crotch and click go the handcuffs."
"The trouser suit plus that wig of yours. No joking matter. I get it." Poldi sighed and shook her head reprovingly.
"Well, what did Valerie say?" I asked, to nudge her back on track.
"What do you think?"
"Mon Dieu!"
Valerie clapped her hand over her mouth as Poldi, panting and perspiring, flopped down on one of the plastic garden chairs so violently that the seams of her old trouser suit creaked.
"You mean everyone's under suspicion, including me?"
"Not you, Valerie, of course not."
Sighing, Poldi opened her notebook, a recent gift from Uncle Martino, with a flourish. It was the kind FBI types always carry on TV, although Martino realized that the private eye in his favorite crime series never needed a notebook in order to register anything. But the PI was a criminological genius, whereas Poldi... Uncle Martino wasn't so sure about her, if only because of her drinking. I have to confess that Poldi's descriptions of Femina Morta, and more especially of Valerie, had ignited my imagination with a vengeance. I pictured the old country house with its pink, jasmine and bougainvillea-covered walls and dusty interior, its ancient library, faded photographs and crumbling frescoes, palm grove and overgrown garden as an enchanted place where time had stood still. A little paradise, haunted by the ghosts of Bourbon noblemen, where friendly mongrels romped around and destinies were fulfilled. And presiding in the midst of it, or so I imagined, usually at night, was Valerie, as pale and complicated and sensual and ravishingly beautiful as a girl in a French film noir. But although Femina Morta was less than 5 minutes from Torre Akirafi by car, Poldi seemed disinclined to share this new friend and her little paradise with anyone. Whenever I casually suggested accompanying her there for once, she found some threadbare pretext for leaving me behind. Although I didn't take this amiss, I've several siblings after all, so I'm no stranger to envy, my imagination redoubled its efforts to conjure up a magical place with a mysterious mistress more splendidly ethereal than Joseph Conrad or Rider Haggard could have devised. So I thought it only fair for me to incorporate Poldi's descriptions in my shambles of a novel. Much later on, when I finally got to know Valerie and Femina Morta, I found they fitted her descriptions to a T. Valerie had wrapped the little dog's body in a silk cloth and laid it out beside the old, disused wine press, where it was dark and quiet. A good resting place for little lady, who had had to endure so much pain at the end of her far too short life, for according to the veterinario, she must have expired in agony. He put the time of death at around 3 a.m. There was no trace of any poisoned bait near the spot in the courtyard where Lady had been found several hours later. So Poldi didn't believe that Lady had ingested the bait in the courtyard, but that she had been deliberately left there later on. And that, according to her logic, precisely accorded with the motive for the killing. On the other hand, she was well aware that nothing endangered the success of an investigation more than jumping to premature conclusions. Rather than excluding any possibility, therefore, she resolved to begin by exploring all lines of inquiry and assemble facts in a strictly objective and professional manner.
Did Lady have any enemies?
Pardon?
I mean, was there anyone who disliked her? Someone she may have nipped or growled at when startled? An inveterate dog-hater, perhaps?
Mon Dieu, no.
Poldi made a note.
Did anything happen yesterday? Anything unusual?
No. Why?
Think carefully. Any detail could be important.
No.
Another note. Professional at work.
When did you last see Lady?
About 9 o'clock last night. I fed both the dogs in the courtyard. I could hear them for a while after that because they were squabbling over a rubber toy that kept on squeaking.
Another note.
And then?
Valerie shook her head. Poldi closed her notebook.
In that case, I'd now like to question your guests. Mon Dieu, is that really necessary?
Valerie had inherited Femina Morta from her father, a descendant of the Sicilian landed nobility. She operated a little palm tree nursery on the small property, which, after several generations of profligacy, ignorance, and mismanagement, represented all that remained of a once extensive family estate. This being far from enough to cover Valerie's running costs, she additionally, and not entirely officially, ran a small B&B and let her numerous empty bedrooms to guests whom she regaled with an unconventional breakfast, comprising coffee, toast, biscuits, fresh avocados, cloyingly sweet French preserves, and stories of her family. All the surrounding land was owned by Italo Russo, whom Poldi had had it in for and thought capable of any atrocity. Russo, too, raised palm trees, but on a far bigger scale. Not just palm trees, either, but olive, lemon, and orange trees, bougainvilleas, strelitzias, and oleanders for supplying to hotels and the owners of sizable properties. Piante Russo was a nurseryman's empire, but my aunt saw it as an ever-expanding pestilence that threatened to absorb Femina Morta as well.
"Because that," she told me once, "would be the final triumph of an unscrupulous upstart over the degenerate aristocracy."
I never discovered whether all Russo really wanted was Valerie herself. It would have been understandable enough, despite their difference in age, but Valerie always firmly denied it, and after all that happened subsequently, I too have my doubts. On the other hand, I can't imagine anyone desiring a piece of jewellery without the jewel. But to revert to Poldi's investigation.
"Tell me about your guests," she said. "They're Germans," Valerie replied. "But, mon Dieu, absolutely delizioso."
For Valerie, like Poldi, happiness possessed a simple binary structure, and the whole of human existence was suspended between the two relatively distant poles, between heaven and hell, love and ignorance, responsibility and recklessness, splendour and scuzz, the essential and the dispensable. And within this dual cosmic structure there existed only two kinds of people, the deliziosi and the spaventosi, the charming and the frightful. Rule of thumb, house guests, friends, and dogs are always deliziosi. The rest are spaventosi, at least until they prove otherwise.
"You see,"
Poldi told me once,
"Valerie has understood that happiness is a simple equation. Happiness equals reality minus expectation. If you don't expect too much, you're less disappointed and happier quicker, get it?
The converse is only logical. If you do expect too much..." She looked at me. "But I've no need to tell you that." My Auntie Poldi was an expert at boosting one's self-confidence. However, the deliziosi claimed to have heard and seen nothing. Nor could Turi and Mario, who tended Femina Morta's palm cuttings, contribute more to the investigation and an expression of their sorrow at Lady's death. Doris was the eminence grise of a five-strong party of German deliziosi, former schoolmistresses from Bad Cannstatt on an educational trip, who had occupied nearly all the vacant rooms in Femina Morta for the past 3 days. They were led by a retired headmaster from Filderstadt, but, to repeat, Doris generally ruled the roost. An athletic 69-year-old clad in sensible clothes and hiking boots, she had keen eyes and a firm sense of how the world should be run, and a dead dog wasn't going to upset her world order unduly. Although the other four deliziosi were less athletic, they likewise sported sensible clothes and rucksacks as if about to venture into the heart of darkness. At Valerie's request, the little party and their tour guide had duly assembled in the garden, where Poldi was to interrogate them. Poldi had grasped at once that these deliziosi represented a genuine challenge to her criminological neutrality and kind-heartedness.
"You mean because they were anoraks?"
I interjected when she brought me up to date on the evening of my arrival.
I don't know what got into me. I may have been hoping for a smidgen of understanding, but to quote Poldi herself,
happiness equals reality minus expectation. To judge by her look of reproof, I was a puppy that had still to grasp the simplest order to sit.
"Rubbish!" she exclaimed. "People who call other people anoraks are anoraks themselves. I mean, it isn't a question of fashion or taste or life choices."
"So what is it a question of?"
"The shadows of the past.
I realized in a flash that this Doris was just the sort of know-it-all and pessimist that has haunted and harassed me all my life. I was gobsmacked. But I struggled for words. You shouldn't care about such things. I mean, you're talking like Teresa. She sighed. Yes, of course I shouldn't care. But I do, don't you see? It's what's called a backstory wound. Make a note of that for your novel. Without a backstory wound, your characters will be nothing more than puppets. Whether in life or in a novel, each of us is haunted by a shadow that keeps whispering, "Don't become like me, and you'll be better off." You can't help this, and you certainly can't choose your own shadow. Where I'm concerned, Poldi grabbed my half-empty bottle of beer, I've been haunted all my life by a Doris. Prosht! Namaste! Kiss my ass! Criminologically speaking, therefore, Poldi was virtually marking time, and that rather worried her. And in other respects? I said, to change the subject. How's it going with Montana? Between the sheets, you mean, or in general? In general will do me for now. Well, it's complicated. She cleared her throat. He's jealous. Who of? Of my criminological successes, of course. And also, she hummed and hawed, well, of Achille. Typical, Auntie Poldi. I was stunned. Which Achille would that be? Like another beer? A panino, perhaps? Don't change the subject. And don't bully me. I'm getting on a bit, and I'm still your aunt, which means I deserve some respect. There was a brief silence. Then, with a groan, she heaved herself off the sofa, toddled into the kitchen without further comment, and returned carrying a bottle of red wine, which she plunked down on the table in front of me. Thanks, but no. I made a dismissive gesture. It's to look at, not to drink. Don't you notice anything? I scrutinized the bottle. Labelled Polifemo, it was a Nerello Mascalese from Etna, produced by a vineyard named Avola. Neither name meant anything to me, but I'm no wine expert. At a loss, I rotated the bottle in both hands. The label depicted a kind of map of the vineyard. The typography was probably meant to convey a classical impression, but looked as if it had been doodled just before the lunchtime break by a student intern at a provincial advertising agency. Pretty label. It is, isn't it? Poldi beamed. Vito said so too. Well, then I met Achille, and everything became rather complicated. Chapter 2
Tells of love at a mature age, of discontinued lines and chest hair, of ashes and wine, of dreamy places. The taste of murder weapons, and Montana and his current case. Poldi gets a brush off and loses her temper. She chances on a preliminary clue, meets two old acquaintances, and loses her temper again. She is rescued, goes up in flames, and, no, doesn't lose her temper, just tells a white lie for which she pays soon afterwards. Until a few weeks earlier, Vito Montana had been morosely and rather bitterly looking forward to the end of his career as the Polizia di Stato's chief inspector in charge of homicide cases in Ashiriale. Morosely, because that was in the nature of the man, and bitterly because a Roman senator whose toes the cussed commissario had trodden on in the course of a murder inquiry had engineered his transfer from Milan to Sicily in order to silence him. And although Vito Montana was a native of Giare, he detested Sicily with the fervour of a grand inquisitor. Then he made the acquaintance of my Auntie Poldi, and in a curiously touching way, the two of them seemed destined for one another. Two slightly scratched and dented leftovers from the jumble sale of life, they had been put on sale once more by a wanton fate. Roll up, roll up, last chance to buy. On the one hand, Commissario Montana of the crumpled suits, a stocky but, by Poldi's standards, well-built man in his late 50s, with a greying beard, green eyes and a permanent frown, a dogged detective by trade, and, according to my Auntie Poldi, a sexual force of nature. And there beside him, ecco là, my aunt herself. Only a little older, she was a glamorous, baroque apparition in her wig and Nefertiti makeup, and booze and depression notwithstanding, still afire with joie de vivre and wholesome Bavarian passion. They made a dramatic, uneasy couple for whom complicated wasn't the word. I likened them to two charged elementary particles hurled at one another at the speed of light by fate's cyclic accelerator. In other words, they resembled my great-grandfather Barnaba and his unbearably beautiful Eleonora in the novel I'd made so little progress with in recent weeks. That had to change, and fast. At all events, Montana's response to Poldi's investigation of the lady case was a trifle irritable.
Of course it's awful about poor little lady, but Madonna, dogs get poisoned every day in this country. Farmers have been putting out poisoned bait to keep strays off their land since the time of the Caesars. We aren't as sentimental about animals as you are.
They were lying together in Poldi's bed in her darkened bedroom, Friday night. The air conditioning was scooping out fog and injecting cool air. Etna was growling in the distance, palm trees were rustling under a shower of ash, and somewhere across the street a quiz show presenter's hysterical voice rang out, mingled with canned laughter and applause, as if a studio audience were following and commenting on every erotic climax, every sigh, every whispered word that was uttered in number 29 Via Baronessa. Poldi stopped winding Montana's chest hair round her finger, pulled the bedclothes over her bosom and sat up.
What exactly are you implying, Vito?
Montana said nothing. Just rolled over and, with great deliberation, lit a cigarette. Feeling exhausted and mellow after her eruptions of passion and the confluence of two volcanic streams of mature libido, Poldi eyed Montana's hirsute back and wondered if it wouldn't be better to squelch this conversation, which seemed to be taking an unwelcome turn, by applying some gentle massage. However, she was not only curious, but spoiling for a fight.
Well?
You're sticking your neck out again,
Montana growled eventually.
You're only asking for a heap of trouble.
You mean you don't see the bigger picture? The conspiracy?
Montana dragged at his cigarette before replying,
What conspiracy? Look around you. You're popular with everyone.
Poldi looked at him searchingly.
Everyone?
I mean, why not enjoy it? You solved a murder, with my help, of course. That always gives one a kick, I know, but then one falls into a trough.
A trough? What on earth are you talking about, Vito?
Don't get me wrong, Poldi. I know the feeling. One wants to keep going. One wants the next kick right away.
Contentedly, Poldi turned over on her back.
Maybe I'll set up a little detective agency. Everyone keeps sounding me out about it. Agenzia Investigativa Oberreiter. How does that sound?
Montana stubbed out the cigarette he'd only just lit in Poldi's heavy glass ashtray, looking as if something had spoilt the taste of tobacco, and gazed at her.
There won't be another murder case, Poldi. There won't be another case of any kind. Face facts. You aren't the police, and you know it, so your subconscious is trying to fabricate a murder.
Oh, is that what it's doing?
And you'd better drop it.
So you think I've lost touch with reality? That I'm cracked? That I scent conspiracies everywhere?
Montana clicked his tongue and gave a little jerk of the head, the elemental Sicilian equivalent of an offhand negative or a less offhand nonsense. That's not what I meant. He reached for her under the bedclothes.
You're a person with a lot of imagination, Poldi, that's all.
He was right. But he definitely hadn't struck the right note. Poldi brusquely thrust aside that nice, warm, beloved hand and sat up straight in bed, giving vent to a barrage of Bayerisch.
Couldn't you please speak Italian, Poldi? I just don't understand why you're being so touchy.
With an indignant snort, Poldi quit her satin-draped pleasure island. Naked and perspiring,
sans makeup and wig, but utterly unashamed, or so I imagine, she confronted him like a living Stone Age Venus of Willendorf.
"I'm not being touchy. I just think you should leave."
A positively Hanseatic display of serene self-control.
"Oh, come on, Poldi. You know what I..."
Before he could complete the sentence, his shirt and suit came flying through the air towards him.
"Right now, what's more. You may take that tone with that Alessia woman of yours, but not with me."
Although rather mean of Poldi, this was emotionally quite understandable. Whether calm or stormy, every relationship, even the longest and most enlightened, brings with it a sediment composed of unspoken expectations, minor wounds, petty fears, and unanswered questions. All is well as long as the flow remains unobstructed, but if the sediment forms a sandbank, it divides the river, creates dangerous eddies, and, if worst comes to worst, causes a total blockage. Alessia was the sandbank in the river of Poldi's love for Vito Montana. She was Montana's girlfriend. 25 years younger, Alessia was beautiful and clever and temperamental and 100 other things Poldi worried about whenever she was once more contending on her own with depression and the urge to get blind drunk. Alessia was Montana's convenient emergency exit, but Poldi remained tolerant. I often wondered why she didn't simply go mad with jealousy. Although quick to take offense, being a Sicilian, Montana sportingly accepted his dismissal. Text messages. Irate, conciliatory, wounded, mollifying, irritated, obscene, affectionate, surged back and forth a little later and over the next few days like tides lapping the opposite shores of a stormy ocean. And on the following Friday, the couple wound up back in the sack like two teenagers. Things could have gone on like this forever if... Yes. If life were not a state of constant flux and we weren't powerless against it. Sooner or later, every spring loses its resilience and goes limp. Sooner or later, the air escapes from every balloon and someone needs to blow it up again. Sooner or later, the wheel of fortune turns, and Montana and Poldi were not exempt from this process. But I'm getting ahead of myself. So, Montana and Poldi fell on each other like animals when the following Friday came. Everything went smoothly. The conflagration of lust was followed by a short breather. Montana smoked a cigarette. Poldi fed him with morsels of mortadella. They shared a beer and she pumped him about his current case. It was only natural, given that Poldi was making no progress with the lady case, that she should want at least to dip her finger in the honeypot of a current murder inquiry, if only for her inner equilibrium's sake. And Montana, being no fool either, appreciated this. Besides, he was happy to be able to circumnavigate certain sandbanks, certain awkward questions affecting their relationship in this way.
"We're not really allowed to talk about it."
Poldi nodded gravely.
"Of course not."
She gave him a look.
"Madonna, come off it. Tell me."
A female district attorney from Catania had been found dead in her second home in Asci Reale, hit on the head from behind with a full bottle of wine. Poldi was instantly galvanized. Wine and murder, right up her street.
"Got any photos?"
Montana hesitated.
"It isn't a pretty sight."
"Look at me, Vito. Do I look as if anything could upset me now?"
He sighed.
"Not here. Not in bed."
Poldi liked it that Montana respected the dead and wasn't a cynic, even though he liked to act the part. They quickly pulled on some clothes. Montana spread out some crime scene photos on the kitchen table and fetched himself a beer. Poldi braced herself for a moment, then looked. The first photo of the crime scene showed the district attorney's body lying in a pool of congealed blood and red wine and littered with shattered glass. Her name was Elisa Puglisi, unmarried. No husband, no ex-husband, no children. Both parents already dead. A 40-something spinster who had obviously put her career before all else. The cleaning woman hadn't found her until the day after she was murdered.
But she was quite a dish,
Poldi exclaimed when Montana showed her a photo of Elisa from happier days. A slim woman with a pale, thin face, she was looking straight at the camera. And everything about her, the slightly aggressive posture, the blue trouser suit, the way she was holding her briefcase, the compressed lips, conveyed determination and disapproval. Everything, that is, except the wealth of dark, untamed curls that overflowed Elisa Puglisi's shoulders. Poldi turned the photo this way and that beneath the kitchen's overhead light as if this would enable her to see through Elisa's mask and gain some idea of her backstory wound.
Because mark my words, she told me once, a detective must always work out what the murder victim is trying to tell them.
You, of course, will object that the dead can't talk, but you'd be wrong.
They can say a great deal. You just have to ask them the right questions, like, what made you a murder victim?
Are you telling me that, fundamentally, murder victims are always guilty of their own deaths?
Nonsense. It's always the murderer who's guilty.
But a lot of things may have happened before a murder takes place. What did the victims say or do or fail to do that caused someone to go and kill them? The backstory. Know what I mean? You always have to know that.
But the severe-looking woman in the photo didn't divulge her secret. There were no witnesses. No one had heard or seen a thing. The perpetrator had continued to batter Elisa Puglisi from behind until the bottle broke, but by then she was dead.
Wine bottles are robust, you know,
Poldi told me in a professional tone.
It's not like in the movies where they smash at once and the cowboy shakes his head and all's well. Forget that. In real life, the second blow usually desecrates a corpse.
Forensics had discovered neither fingerprints nor traces of DNA on the bottle, and no clues were present on the body or in the apartment.
A pro, Montana surmised.
Poldi knitted her brow and reshuffled the crime scene photos on the table.
What professional killer kills with a wine bottle?
Perhaps it was meant to look like a personal matter.
Poldi was unconvinced, especially as she sensed Montana's own doubts.
She'd had sex a few hours prior to death, he said.
Who with?
We're working on that.
Poldi thought for a moment.
A district attorney, eh? They easily make enemies. Have you examined her cases?
We're doing so.
Can't you be a bit more specific?
Montana sighed.
I shouldn't tell you this, Poldi.
She looked at him.
But?
He drained his beer before replying.
Elisa Puglisi headed the DDR of Catania province.
The what?
The Direzione Distrettuale Antimafia, the Anti-Mafia Public Prosecution Department.
There you are, then,
Poldi exclaimed delightedly.
The whole thing's as clear as daylight.
Nothing's clear until it's clarified, Montana growled. We're pursuing a number of lines of inquiry, but it's quite possible that I'll soon have the case taken out of my hands by some smart lads from the Direzione Investigativa Antimafia in Rome.
What a bummer.
You can say that again.
You need my help, Vito.
Forget it, Poldi.
I mean, I could...
I said, forget it.
He tried to take the photos back, but Poldi wasn't finished yet. Something about them had puzzled her. Not just the look of the corpse, but a detail that had briefly caught her eye without really registering. She carefully examined one photo after another, until she lighted on it. She almost uttered an exclamation, but she had herself under control. She turned the photo 90 degrees and showed it to Montana.
How about that?
What do you mean?
The remains of the wine bottle. Have you looked at them closely?
Montana picked up the photo and scrutinized it.
An Etna Rosso, he said with a shrug. Nice label. What's so special about it?
Poldi wondered for a moment whether to tell him, but she hadn't cared for his previous tone at all.
Oh, forget it, she said airily. A very pretty label, I agree, and such an original idea to use a map of the vineyard. Do you know the Avila Vineyard?
Montana eyed her suspiciously.
What makes you ask, Poldi?
But Poldi had already stood up. Letting her silk kimono slither to the floor, she went back into the bedroom.
That's enough detective work, Vito. Namaste. Life beckons.
Will you at least tell me?
I asked when she recounted the episode to me later.
You mean you still haven't caught on? She cried in amazement.
Why, it's as plain as the nose on your face.
Then please spell it out for the benefit of the unenlightened.
Poldi disappeared into the bedroom for a moment and returned with a photo which she propped against the wine bottle. It displayed a topographical map that looked vaguely familiar to me. And then I finally caught on.
The label on the wine bottle displayed the same map that Rousseau and Patanet, who was now under arrest, had been discussing when Poldi was keeping tabs on them in the Valentino case.
Good for you, Poldi,
I whispered, highly impressed.
It's not a bad wine, that Polifemo,
Poldi said triumphantly.
A genuine Etna Rosso, robust, dark and elegant, with good length and oomph, a spectacular finish and soft, mysterious almond notes. Liquid commissario, so to speak. 94 Parker points, you don't get that sort of stuff in a supermarket. A disgrace using such noble wine for such a nefarious purpose. Like to try a drop?
No thanks, I said. I don't fancy drinking from a murder weapon.
Well, now you can see how obvious the connection was, can't you? District attorney, mafia, Russo, murder.
But don't you think that's a bit, far-fetched?
Lack of imagination is the little sister of timidity. You'll never get anywhere with your novel like that.
It's true. My Auntie Poldi really did have my best interests at heart.
But what's the connection with this man, Achille, and Montana's jealousy?
Poldi tapped the wine label.
Why, Achille is the owner of the vineyard.
Like so many things in Sicily, the story of winemaking there is one of superb resources, ignorance, greed, mediocrity, neglect, destruction, deliberation, a fresh start, and triumph. No one knows that better than my uncle Martino, because he knows everything about Sicily and fills in any gaps with figments of his imagination. Like everything in Sicily, wine is very ancient, and grown in the furrows of conquest and occupation. According to my uncle Martino, the Phoenicians brought the first grape varieties to Sicily, but quality wines weren't produced there until the end of the 19th century. Well, quality. Soulless, mass-produced wine for the English market quickly degenerated into the production of cheap Marsala. Sweet enough to make your teeth itch, it was sometimes spiked with almond syrup. You can still get this stuff in souvenir shops, and you're welcome to it. The general ignorance and lousy quality are surprising when one considers the importance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.